to adapt, but let it not be a barrier for us. If you guys need a mask, we have some disposable ones provided at the door, so feel free to help yourself to one of those. You may see some of our staff temporarily not wearing a mask, and that's because of their specific responsibilities. Like, I don't think you'd understand me quite as good right now if I had a mask on, but we will be wearing them throughout the service. So thank you for helping us with that. And then I also wanted to announce that this Tuesday is going to be our next student ministries night. So if you have a middle school or teenage student who wants to come and hang out with us, we meet every second and fourth Tuesdays of the month at my husband and I's house to just hang out and have a good time getting to know each other a little bit better. So that's going to be coming up this Tuesday from 7 to 8:30 p.m. If you're new with us here today, we'd love to connect with you and answer any questions you guys might have. So you can text the word new or here to 219-233-2311, and we'll reach out with you sometime throughout the week. So other than that, if you call Rethink Church your home and you would like to give to the vision and mission of Rethink Church, we have a couple ways you can do so. You can either give, there's a black box at the back by the door that you can give in person, or you can give online at rethinkchurch.cc. Lean in as Mark comes up and shares the next piece of our sermon series.
I've been going to Rethink for a while now, a few months, and Mark has asked me to share this morning's scripture with you for the message. So we are going to be reading Matthew 12, verses 15 through 21, if you'd like to follow along. But when Jesus knew it, he withdrew from there, and great multitudes followed him, and he healed them all. Yet he warned them not to make him known, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, "Behold, my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved in whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him, and he will declare justice to the Gentiles. He will not quarrel, nor cry out, nor will anyone hear his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, and smoking flax he will not quench, till he sends forth justice to victory. And in his name, Gentiles will trust." Have a great day.
Welcome back to church. There we go. So here we are. We are in the same passage. And if you notice, we read the same passage again. Here's why. I didn't feel like keeping you guys here for 3 hours last week, so we decided to do two messages of this one. So this is like part two of last week. And if you missed last week, you can go to catch up on rethinkchurch.cc. But here's a quick recap. Jesus is having a bad day. I would say anytime somebody plots to kill you, that's a bad day. And that's what he's done. He's challenged the status quo. Now the religious leaders are upset with him. He's doing something that is just amazing to me as he continually does this. And as he's having a bad day and people are plotting to kill him, he goes out and he heals people. Like, that's what he does. That's how he responds. And we said this, we don't actually control what happens to us, but we can 100% get to control how we respond to things. And what we should follow in his example is this. As bad things happen and as resistance comes his way, he continually bleeds the gospel. He's continually saying, I'm just going to go out and heal people. I'm going to demonstrate what the kingdom of God is going to be like, to take something that is broken or fractured or wrong, and I'm going to make things right. And this is how he continually leads. And we said this, that the gospel is this. It's a great message, and it sounds very harsh that we've all sinned. The message of the gospel is that we've all sinned. It's not like, hey, there's rankings of sins. It's just that we've all sinned. And the beautiful thing about it is that Jesus died instead of us. He died for us, he died in our place, that his sacrifice is how we find our salvation. And he continually is doing this. He's showing this, he's demonstrating this. And as he's doing this, he just continually leads into these things. And here's the reality of it. I think it's because of his worldview that he responds this way. The way that he sees the world, the way that he sees himself, how the creation took place, how he continually finds himself in the worldview that is grounded in Scripture, which is the Hebrew Scriptures at his time, so that anything in the Old Testament is his Bible. That's what we have to realize, that like, this is what Jesus continually read, this is what Jesus continually went to. And the reason that he can quote Isaiah is because he continually went back to the synagogue. He continually showed up and said, this is what I want to do. And I'm like, they didn't have the Bible app at the time. They didn't even have, like, what we have, like, we walk around with a Bible in our hand, if you have a leather-bound one or a paper one. They didn't have that. Like, they had these communal areas and villages and stuff like that, that they would have these scrolls, these leather-bound rolls of the scripture. And so he would show up and he would learn this communally, and this is how he started memorizing this. So as he's having these bad days, he's responding in such a way that is gospel-driven, like he's demonstrating the gospel because of his groundedness in the scriptures. He's continually coming back to this worldview saying, this is how we're going to do this. And so he goes in and he has this worldview that is grounded in scripture. And I think what we have to realize is this, like we can have a worldview based on anything. The way that we look at the world is it influences how we interact with this world. If we have a worldview that is different than outside of scripture, then we're going to interact with something that is different than outside of scripture. And a lot of times I think, and it's very, like I was a student ministries pastor for 16 years, and I saw students all the time finding the cultural hot topic and then saying, that's my worldview right there. And they have this, they ran the risk of saying this is going to be outdated at some point, right? Like this is just part of the reality of it. That when we do this, it's very difficult to understand that like our worldview is going to be, like it shapes everything that we do. And here's what I mean by worldview. How did the world come into existence? What am I doing here in this life? And where am I headed towards in the way I'm going to live or how we're going to interact with each other? That's like another theologian says it this way. When you think of God, what do you think of? That's your worldview. This is one of the foundational things. A lot of times we try to create a worldview, and then we pick and choose passages of the scripture and say, this is my worldview, and I can justify it by the Bible. And what Jesus models for us is this, that we should continually submit to the worldview that we find in scriptures. And that we should continually look at this and interact with the world that way, based on what we see in the scriptures. This is why Jesus goes into when he says this, and he goes to the next passage, like this, and he says, here's my servant who I've chosen. We talked about that last week. And he says, like, I will proclaim the justice to the nations. There's a ton of, like, messages of justice these days, isn't there? And rightfully so. Part of my time as a student ministries pastor, we would talk about injustice and all the way that we see it just played out all throughout our culture. And the ways that we continually work through this is crucial. But my hesitation, what I continually see and what I continually talk to my students was this. I think what you're actually talking about is vengeful and not justice. And those two things are not the same thing. And we have to be aware of that, and we have to be concerned with, like, are we seeing people in revenge, or do we see people, like, trying to live out justice? And we have to get an understanding of what justice really is, and the way we do that is we look at all the way back in the very beginning of the scriptures. And we see that Jesus, God created the earth, and he elevated humanity above all of the creation. And he said, rule this justly, meaning this, like, treat everybody equally, with dignity and respect. And he also said, like, make sure you steward the earth and all of its creation as well as you can. Like, capture the potential of all creation. Now, we all know how this played out, right? Like, humans sinned, injustice, and all the other stuff issued, like, came into existence. And then, a couple generations later, this guy named Abram, God calls him out in Genesis chapter 18. Here's what he says about Abraham. He says this, I have chosen him, talking about Abraham, this is God speaking, that he may command his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, so that the Lord may bring Abraham, like, all the promises that he's given him. This concept of bringing righteousness and justice is continually linked together all throughout Scripture. Now, we've seen this play out over and over again, where once sin entered the world, injustice, exploiting the vulnerable, taking advantage of people, just continually is the cycle that got repeated. And we have to recognize that. And this is not an issue that just has taken place in North America. This is not an issue of white and all the other minorities. This is an issue of like all throughout cultures. Every continent is seeing people exploited and taking advantage of people. Like, people in Asia have taken advantage of other people in other countries in Asia. People in South America did this to other countries and other South American nations. People like Native Americans have done that with other Native American tribes. Europeans did it with each other in the other European countries. Africans, same thing. And the cycle's just continually gotten repeated and repeated. And the reality of it is this is a symptom of our culture, our condition. of sin. That whenever we fall into sin, we continually live into this cycle. And it's this issue that has plagued humanity since Genesis chapter 3. And the gospel is this, that God has come with a solution in the form of Jesus. And Abraham sends this, like, this promise out that justice and righteousness is going to be the way that his children deal with this. And his children have talked about this. Proverbs 31, here's what the author says here. He says this, justice will speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. For the rights of those who are destitute, speak up for and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and the needy. A prophet, around the same time with Isaiah, his name is Jeremiah, he says this, this is what the Lord says, do what is just and right. Rescue from the hand of the oppressor and the one who has been robbed. Do no wrong or violence to the foreigner, the fatherless, or the widow. And do not shed innocent blood in this place. The psalmist says in Psalm 146, God remains faithful forever, executing justice for the exploited and giving food to the hungry. The Lord frees the prisoners. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord raises up those who are oppressed. And the Lord loves the righteous. The Lord protects the resident aliens and helps the fatherless, the widow, but he frustrates the way of the wicked. Mm-hmm. And think about this, like the way of the righteous and the justice people are we frustrating the ways of the wicked and the way we live our life? This is one of those concepts that we continually need to lean into. And if, like, our worldview is shaped by Scripture, then we live and the way we interact with humanity will deal with this as well. Like, we don't just say, I have this worldview, I'm sitting on my island. None of us are isolated people, right? Like, it's so easy to order things from Amazon and just order our groceries and we don't have to interact with people. But that's not the way that God created us to live. The way that Jesus continually models this is what we call incarnation, like where God comes and dwells with us. And the levels of incarnation that are there is just so crucial to us. And it's something that we probably model. And what we see in Matthew chapter 11 and 12 is Jesus' incarnation just continually leads to these four things. Number one, he has a great reputation. Like Jesus has these crowds continually following him. And then, in what the setup for this concept that we're dealing with right now in this passage in Matthew 12 is that he has a conversation with religious leaders. They start asking him questions. Hey, why do your disciples do this? Hey, why do you do this? And he's continually talking with them. This is what incarnation does. It leads to a great reputation, to having a conversation, and now he's bringing the confrontational truth. And this is where he's quoting Isaiah 41 about the bruised reed and all this. He's bringing confrontational truth to them. And if we allow him, after that confrontation, he will transform us. The religious leaders, they did not really react to the confrontational truth that well. But if we wanted to follow him and say, how do we change this world? It's not by living in our mom's basement and blogging about all the life experiences that we had and saying, this is what I know. And this is like, no, we actually get involved. We follow the model that Jesus did. And as we live incarnationally, like what we find is we have great reputation, we have conversations with, and at times there's going to be some confrontational truth. And if we allow the Holy Spirit, start learning and leading into how we transform in this regard. And I think there's something beautiful that he does. When Jesus mentions, he's quoting Isaiah, and he's talking about the bruised reed and the smoldering wick or the smoldering flax, depending on what passage or translation you look at. These are euphemisms of somebody who has, like, a bruised reed was it's something very, funny to me. The way that Isaiah would have written this down was with a reed pen. Like, these pens made out of reed, and if it's bruised, then it's no good, and it was just broken and thrown it away. Because it's not staying vertical, it's not staying to the point where he can write, it's like flimsy, just like flailing around, and he can't actually write with it. And so, he's talking about, if it's a bruised reed, you're just going to dispose of it. And it was a euphemism of saying, somebody with damaged goods, somebody with a defect, somebody with a broken, shriveled hand. Remember what Jesus just did on the Sabbath? He healed a man with a shriveled hand. Mm-hmm. And that's what really just set everybody off in Matthew chapter 12 and 11. Because he did it on the Sabbath. And somebody with a smoldering wick. When a candle's ran its course and all the wax is done and it starts smoldering because it's right at the end of its life cycle. This is how they would have seen in the dark. So they're very, dispendable. You just throw it away, you get a new candle. And what does Jesus say here, though? He's talking about justice, and he's saying, when I see a bruised reed, I'm not just going to dispose of it. I'm not going to throw it away. And when I see a smoldering wick, where the most productive days were found behind, like in the previous days, I'm not going to snuff it out. He is graciously and patiently loving us. And he's waiting for something to come of redemption. And there's something beautiful that takes place here as he's watching us. And I think the way we have a worldview, it changes the way or influences the way we interact with people. Jesus' worldview is founded in Scripture. And the Scripture says this, that all humanity is made in God's image. That there's no like flaw, there's no mistakes in God's creation. We brought the mistakes on. We brought sin, right? And so the pain and the suffering that we see that we brought on ourselves because of the sin of this world. But in God's creation, it's a great creation. And I think we have to look, like, realize this. I don't know about you, but anybody have that crazy uncle or that crazy grandparent who has, like, very different views of you than you do? Let's take the topic of race. My best friend growing up, his family came from northern Mexico. He was a second-generation immigrant. His name was Richie. He and I just hung out all the time in Plymouth, Indiana. And he would come over to our house at times when we had like family get-togethers, and I would go to their house. And we had, both of us have relatives that just said racial, like, racist comments that was just like, dude, seriously, shut up. Like, don't say that, you know? Like, he came over to my house one time, and one of my relatives was, he made this stupid side, like, comment. Like, nobody in my family, like, reacted. I was like, dude, shut up. And Rich is like, it's fine, don't worry. And I was like, no, it's really not. And then next weekend, I go to his house, and some of his relatives, like, I don't know about you, but like, there's some reason I had a very hard time hearing the majority of what they had to say. But then all of a sudden, when this lady said this, I was like, oh, he was like, she goes, that fat white cracker's not gonna be able to eat my food and like not be able to dance. I could hear that perfectly. And I was like, what the heck? And Richie's like, dude, shut up. Like, you can't say that about my friend. Like, we all have those people, right? Like, and 100 years ago, it was deemed acceptable to talk like that about each other. It was just how people interacted. I'm not condoning it, I'm just saying, like, that's how culturally it was taken. And what I realize is, hey, when we create a worldview based on the cultural hot topic, we can easily become those crazy old people and our relatives that 100 years ago, people were like, man, they were crazy, right? And now you look at it and say, like, how damaging or how dangerous would it be to create a worldview based on a cultural hot topic and not have a significant scripture? We should never create a worldview and say, this is my worldview, and this is how I'm going to deal with things, and I'm going to pick and choose the Bible passages that help me feel good about this worldview, and not have it be tested in the, like, culture of the scriptural truth. This is not what Jesus does. Jesus takes a worldview based on scripture, and he interacts with the world. It is crucial for us to understand that. And the way he does this, he says this, I'm not going to, like, see people as expendable. I'm not going to look at people and say, you're at the end of your life and you should just be replaced. He does not do that. 100 years ago, this concept of eugenics was a legitimate way of doing science. If you were a up-and-coming scientist, you would study eugenics, especially in biology. And 100 years ago, they had eugenics conferences, and both all throughout Europe and in America, especially in New York City. Even in America, there was a Eugenics Society of America. Now, if you're not familiar with eugenics, here's what the concept of eugenics is. Let me pull up the definition of it. It says this, it's the belief in the possibility of improving the qualities of the human species by discouraging the reproductions of persons having a defect of genetic defect or undesirable traits. This is what they got together and talked about in science. And here's the reality of it. Eugenics is actually the logical conclusion of Darwinism or evolution. If we've just evolved and we've become the best species of all creation over millions of years, then we don't want anything but the best reproducing itself. And so Darwinism is like the very next step is eugenics, saying, hey, let's protect the genetic chain of events and make sure that the best, whoever we've deemed the best, being that. And there's all these leaders that got together and they talked about this. One of the guys, his name is J.B.S. Haldane, and here's what he says. The optimization of human gene pool is accomplished by preventing certain types of people from breeding. Like, imagine getting together today and having this conversation in a scientific field. One of the theologians that we've looked at is like one of the modern day heroes is C.S. Lewis. C.S. Lewis, before he was a Christian, was an atheist, and he was wrestling through how eugenics was possible. Is it legitimate? Is it one of those things that we should really consider? He was an Oxford professor, and he was just wrestling through all this, not knowing what to do. And he started leaning towards eugenics. He started attending some of the conversations and the conferences there. One other guy, his name was Bertrand Russell. He says this, the state or the government should actually be empowered to sterilize anybody with defects, mentally or physically. By reducing the number of idiots, imbeciles, feeble-minded society would actually benefit from the potential of, if we actually over-sterilize people, it would actually, the benefit would outweigh the negative part. Like, imagine getting together and saying that. Like, this is a legitimate way of doing science. One of the leaders here in America, her name is Margaret Sanger. She says this as she's writing for the American Eugenics Society. Eugenics improves the genetic composition of humans through controlled reproduction of different races and classes. She went on to say in a New York Times article in April 1923, eugenics means the release of the cultivation of a better racial element in our society and the gradual suppression, elimination, and eventual eradication of stocks of human weeds, which threaten the blooming of the finest flowers in the American civilization. As a member of the American Eugenics, she went on to start Planned Parenthood, which has legally aborted millions of babies in America. This is the foundation of what we, like some of the things that we're seeing in our culture. It's because of this concept of eugenics and how we interact, how we have a worldview, and how we interact with people. It all matters. And if we take a cultural hot topic and we create this is our worldview without submitting it to the truth of Scripture, we could easily become these kind of people. That in 100 years our grandkids are going to be like, what the heck were they thinking? And how do we interact? Like, how do we even get to this point? And the reality of it is, it's so easy to do this. And what does Jesus say? He says this in John chapter 1, that the law came through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus. And if we stop pursuing the truth, and if we just continually go after the hot cultural hot topic or the next cultural hot topic, saying this is how I'm going to form my worldview, and this is how I'm going to interact with people, we can easily fall into this trap. C.S. Lewis, once he became a follower of Jesus, and he talks about it wasn't like this moment, this aha moment. It's like he talks about like all the rooms in his house, and he's thinking about his life, is all the furniture just started rearranging, and all of a sudden he came to this conclusion that Jesus was real, and that Jesus actually died for my sins. Then he completely abandoned this, and he starts speaking out of the dangers of eugenics, and he's like, there's no way that this is legitimate, and there's no way that the followers of Jesus should ever even consider this. And as he's writing what some of us consider the greatest words in the Chronicles of Narnia, the reason he starts having the animals start speaking to children is because of his worldview. And he's saying that the reason is, and if you read some of the Chronicles of Narnia, you see this mouse named Reepicheep, and he's challenging this little spoiled little brat named Eustace, and he's saying, this is how you actually become a better human. And it's all because of his worldview of saying there's no way a follower of Jesus could actually follow eugenics. And that all creation is made in God's image. And that we all can learn from each other. And Jesus, in Matthew 12, he goes on, he says, I will not snuff those people out. One of the challenging ways of reading Scripture, some theologians say that you should put yourself as the hero of the story. One of the challenges of the temptation is to actually read this and say, well, I'm going to be like Jesus. I'm going to interact this story. Like, I look at people and say, well, I'm looking at that person as a damaged reed. Do I see this person as a smoldering wick? And there's that temptation and how we interact with people. We should follow Jesus' model here. But here's the reality of it, the harsh reality of it, is that myself and yourself, we are the damaged reeds. And we are the smoldering wicks. Because we've allowed sin into this world. And we have continually lived into sin. And what does Jesus say here? He's not going to break us and throw us away. He's not going to snuff us out. He graciously and shows so much patience and so much love towards us. That's how he interacts with us. He lovingly points us to the cross time and time again. He lovingly declares the gospel. And if we fall into this trap of saying we don't need a savior, then we're running the risk of blindly just going through life and saying, I don't need to come to the realization and repent of anything. And that Jesus loved me so much just because of who I am and what I could produce for him, and all this other stuff, we fall into this trap of like the cycle of production and production and production. And what we see in the scriptures and Jesus and the way he interacts with us is that our value doesn't come from what we can produce. Our value comes in whose image we're made in. Mm-hmm. And as followers of Jesus, that is the foundational thing of our worldview, that we have to get into that reality and say, this is how I see people, because I'm creating God's image. You're creating God's image. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but it was in our sin that Jesus died for us. He came to this earth and he died for us. Jesus goes on and quotes another part of the same passage in Isaiah, and he talks about the hope of the nations. And the hope, the idea of hope here is that we're anticipating a better future than the reality that we're experiencing today. And hope is not in circumstances. Hope is not in conditions and saying, oh, things are just going to get better. Biblical hope is actually found in Jesus. And that's something we have to come back to time and time again. And the biblical words for hope, one of them in Hebrew is yahal, which means that you just simply wait. Like Noah after the flood, he had to yahal for the waters to recede. So he just had to wait for the water to go down. Another one is kavah, and it's the same root word as cord, and it's that tension that gets pulled when you pull a cord tight. And it's this anticipation, like the farmers would talk about yahaling and kavahing over and over again because they planted the seed and they're hoping for a better harvest so they could live and just have this benefit. And they talk about it time and time again. And the thing that they point back to in the Hebrew scriptures is the Exodus event, where God saved them out of slavery and bondage. The New Testament writers, they have this Greek word of elpis, and it's this event of the elpis, the hope for them is the resurrection of Jesus. And they talk about, like, it's not the circumstances. It's not this concept of, like, things are just going to get better because, you know, we hope so. No, the things that would get better because of who Jesus is. And they continually talk about, like, going back to that event of the resurrection. Peter talks about, like, in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13, he says, like we're going to continually just go back to the resurrection. It's a new, it's a living hope that they find themselves in. The prophet Hosea, he talks about in this valley of trouble, God or Yahweh could turn this entire thing into a doorway of hope. And the reality of it is, if we continually think that all things are just going to get better because fill in the blank, without Jesus, we're missing the idea of what hope is. We're missing the reality that we are the bruised reed in the smoldering wick. And that Jesus is continually lovingly pointing us towards the cross. That the good news is that he died for our sins, even though we were the bruised reed in the smoldering wick, and he is the one that is continually leading into that and pointing us towards the hope of a better tomorrow because of what he has planned and what he's done for us. Let's pray. Jesus, thanks for this day. Thanks for who you are. Jesus, thanks that the hope of this world is in you and nothing else. That it's not in the reality or the thought of things will just get better just because. But Jesus, you died for us, and you rose from the tomb. And your life and your example, your sacrifice, is the source of our hope. And that we should continually lean in to a scriptural worldview, God, to help us interact with people the way that you want us to. We love you, Jesus. Genuinely pray this. Have a seat. My hope and our prayer for this Sunday is that we would just simply have a worldview found in Scripture and interact with each other in the ways that Jesus would interact with us. Church, I want you to know this to be true, that God loves you and that I love you. And as we follow him, we'll encounter the best he has to offer. So let's go and be the church. Have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday.